My name is Sherry Menor McNamara, and I'm with the Chamber of Commerce. First, I'd like to thank all of you for attending our very first forum. We do this every 2 years based on what races are up that year. So this one especially is going to be an exciting one with five of the candidates here today, as well as the number of different races this election year, including the governors, lieutenant governors, CD1, and of course all the different seats are opening up on at the state legislature on the Senate and House side. Before I introduce our moderator, I'd like to recognize a couple of our board members. One, Stafford Kiguchi from Bank of Hawaii. And our past board chair, Dennis Francis. So, of course, without our board and their support, we wouldn't be able to do what we do today. So thank you for being here. So at this time, I will introduce our moderator, who will introduce the candidates. Dr. John Hart, if you don't know him, he is a professor at the HPU, and also he's an active commentator, especially during the political season. And he's been our moderator for the past couple forums that we've had, so we're excited that he agreed to return. Dr. Hart will describe what the procedure and the rules are. But I will let you know that all the candidates were given a list of issues, but they do not know the specific questions. So again, they're given a list of potential issues that will be asked last week. But with that said, I am going to turn it over to Dr. Hart to explain in detail the timing and everything else you need to know of what's going to go on today. So please help me welcome Dr. Hart.
So they have me sitting away from you as I do the intros. If you're old enough to remember Eric Clapton playing to the amplifier, I guess that's what I'm doing. Okay. First of all, I'd like to introduce our candidates for CD1. We have Lieutenant Governor Doug Chin. State Representative Beth Fukumoto. State Representative Paniela Ng. State Senator Dada Mikado Kim. City and County of Honolulu Council Member Ernie Martin. For today's format, please be seated. For today's format, each candidate will be provided with 2 minutes for an opening statement, followed by a series of Q&A. I will ask a question. Each candidate will have 1 minute to answer. The same candidate will be going in alphabetical order, moving one down every time. So first time will be to Mr. Chin. Second time, we'll start with Ms. Fukumoto, et cetera, et cetera. I will be very strict on the time limits, and there will be no rebuttals. As we noted, questions were not provided beforehand. They were provided topics. Following the Q&A, each candidate will be provided with 2 minutes for a closing statement. Very good. We will start with opening remarks. We will start with Lieutenant Governor Chin.
Thanks a lot, Professor Hart. Aloha and good afternoon, everybody. I'm Governor Chin. I'm the Lieutenant Governor for the state of Hawaii. Do you want me to talk louder?
Turn the mic on.
I can use my loud voice.
Okay. Use your outside voice.
Great, I can do that. So, hello everybody, I'm Doug Chin. I'm the son of immigrants. My mother was a university librarian for 40 years. My father was a civil engineer. And it's probably no surprise, but the values that they taught me when I was growing up was to work hard and to study hard, but also it was to find ways to be able to give back to the community in everything that I ever did. And so I have a background, an extensive background of public service, as well as experience within the private sector. Starting with when I was a prosecutor, I prosecuted mainly domestic violence cases and sexual assault cases. I took a lot of stands for victims' rights during that time. But also notably, I have always testified, even from back in that day, for Hawaii's very strict gun control laws. And I'm proud to say that Hawaii has the strictest gun laws in the United States. Later on, I became managing director of the city and county of Honolulu in 2010 under Mayor Peter Carlisle. And during that time, there was more than 90 days when I was actually the acting mayor for the city. But during that time, I also had the experience and honor of being able to serve on the Military Affairs Council. And later on, I became the attorney general. I'm the person who had faced down Trump multiple times in court and was victorious there. Now I'm the lieutenant governor. I've also been the managing partner at Carl Smith Ball and had a lot of experience with clients that were small business owners. So I'm very grateful to be able to be here. If I get the opportunity to be able to go to Congress, I will do everything I can to serve.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Beth Fukumoto. I want to first thank you all for being here today and talk a little bit about why I first got involved in politics. When I first got graduated from graduate school in 2008, I was graduating with $50,000 in student loans, which is actually quite small by comparison to others. I was blessed with a scholarship, so my loans were for living expenses and other things, something that many graduates face today. I was coming back to Hawaii in the middle of the recession, trying to find a job, and like many people my age, I couldn't live outside of my parents' home, so I lived with them until I could find a job, and I found work. Working at the state legislature, my job, I had a master's degree, but my job was filing papers because it was all that I could find. And while I did that, I filed papers every day and listened to what was going on in the legislature. And what I heard was a lot of establishment politicians that were just maintaining the status quo while other families in Hawaii struggled to get by. And I saw a number of people that had held on to power for so long that they seemed to have lost touch with the average working family struggle. So I decided to devote my career, get into politics, and devote my career to fighting the status quo, and to using every chance and every tool that I had to try to unrig a system that seemed rigged, and to give voice to people that didn't have a voice. And that was my mission from the very beginning. It's always been my mission. And I think that should always have been with the Democratic Party. It's no secret that I was once a Republican, but I do think that mission should always been in the Democratic Party, because at its best, that is what the Democratic Party is. But when I was 25 and getting involved in politics, that's not what I saw. Once upon a time, our state was on the leading edge of progress. Economic and social justice movements started here. And our small state had a big influence in part because of who we sent to Congress. And we need to be that state again. The way things have always been is not good enough anymore. We know that, not locally and not nationally.
Thank you.
I have to stop. Okay. Just to wrap up, I think the key here is that this could be a change year, and there's plenty of opportunity to lead Hawaii into the future if we send the right person to Congress. Thank you.
My name is Kaniela Ng. Before I get started, I just want to say there's been some press about our past races for State House in my 20s up until last election. And I just want to say that if any mistakes were made, I'm taking full responsibility, and I'm sorry if I let anyone down. So I'm Kaniela Ng. I'm running for Congress because we need new voices, different voices, and our voices in Congress. How many of you think that Congress is doing a fantastic job right now and they're getting so much done? Yeah, you know, the approval rating has been under 20% across the nation for years now. Doesn't matter what party's in power, right? So it's really easy to bash the other party, especially in a Democratic primary. It's really easy to fight Donald Trump because 90% of voters hate him. But what's harder is the standing up to people holding back change in both parties, these multinational monopolies that are not just crushing workers, but crushing small business owners as well here in Hawaii and across the U.S. I fight for local families because I come from one. Right. Neither of my parents went to college. My dad worked at a hotel. He was a waiter. And my mom worked at Liberty House. She sold shoes. But my dad passed away when I was 11 years old, suddenly. So my mom was left with four kids and her grandmother on her own. She would skip meals to make sure we're okay. And I worked in the pineapple fields at 14 years old to help with family bills. And it was through the experience I realized that hard work is great, but it's not enough. Sometimes you really need community and your teachers and even government to help you get by when you're facing hard times. And that's what drives me. I ran for, I was lucky enough to get into Kamehameha Schools and then UH Manoa, where I took out student loans and worked my way through, became student body president. Then I ran against a Republican incumbent in a Republican district at 23 years old. I knocked on every door in the district, 15,000 doors, after working at Four Seasons from 4 a.m. to noon, cleaning locker rooms. And that's the values that I'm going to try to bring to Congress and restore some civility and aloha in this Donald Trump crazy era that we're facing today. Thank you.
Aloha. It's great to see so many friends out in the audience and familiar faces and new ones. You know, in 1982, during my very first campaign, I made a commitment to the voters, and I told them that I would be accessible, accountable, and always put their interests first. And of that commitment, I have never wavered, which is probably why I've had the voters' confidence for the past 35 years, beginning in the State House of Representatives, in the Honolulu City Council, and in the State Senate. Not only have I been accountable, but I've held local and state agencies, departments, and administrators also accountable, fiscally accountable for your tax dollars. I guess you can say I've been like a watchdog where I've led investigations and hearings to get to the bottom of issues such as airport contracts that had cost overruns and change orders, procurement violations at DBED, and Hawaii tourism budgets, as well as salary overpayments and the UH Wonder Blunder. So I make the same commitment now that I will be accessible, accountable, and always put the interests of Hawaii first in Congress. You can count on me to stand up to President Trump and to Education Secretary Betsy DeVos on their policies that could definitely hurt Hawaii. I was the most unlikely person to run for office in 1982. I was a woman, of course. I was from a working mom as a waitress. My dad was a carpenter. They never finished high school. Family of seven of us living in a two-bedroom walk-up apartment in Kalaipalama. We didn't have any running hot water. We didn't have any showers. We were one paycheck away from being homeless. And if not for the public school system, I probably wouldn't be sitting here today. And that's why every day that I've spent as a public servant, I've been a fighter for the people of Hawaii, for working families. And I will take that fighting spirit and be that warrior for you in Congress. Mahalo.
Thank you, Professor. Aloha, Mai Kako. Aloha. You know, it's really a pleasure to be here. My name is Ernie Martin. I only say that because I know I have low name recognition. But you know, asking a Portuguese attorney to stay within the time limit is very challenging, but I'll do the best that I can. But you know, just a little bit about myself. I have my brochure. You know, I was raised in public housing. You know, I am not ashamed of that. I was one of nine siblings. My dad was a U.S. Army combat vet. Didn't graduate from high school. Lied on his birth certificate so he could join the military. My mom is from Japan. When she came to Hawaii, she could speak very limited English. She had to learn English from watching television, like, you know, most immigrants do. You know, but if you know me, my family is primarily versed in military service. We have a very proud history of military service. I probably would have gone that route if my brother didn't pass away in Vietnam, so I chose to go another route. I'm not a politician, you know, I'm a public servant. If you know my career, we started very humbly as a groundskeeper. Eventually, I rose to the ranks. I became an executive cabinet member of two administrations. I've been fortunate my time on the city council. I've been always in leadership. You know, a professor introduced me as council member, but actually it's chairman, you know. It's Chairman Martin. I only say that because I think I'm fortunate. I know Senator has served on the council as well. But, you know, I've been fortunate. I've been blessed that I've been the longest serving chairman in the history of the Honolulu City Council. And I think that's an attestment of who I am as a person and who I am as a leader. And, you know, it's the same value systems I think will carry me well, especially when you look at Washington, D.C., which is very dysfunctional at this point in time. But I always say my favorite saying is this: where there's crisis, there's opportunity. You know, and I think right now we have Washington, D.C. that's in crisis, so I think it presents great opportunity for our next representative. Thank you. You see that? I made it under 2 minutes.
Thank you. We'll now move to Q&A. The first question deals with personal experience. What do you think separates you from the other candidates running for this office? Representative Fukumoto, we will start with you.
Sure, I think one of the things that separates me, I am the only candidate here who has been tested and vetted thoroughly and publicly through my process switching parties. I've been tested by the Democratic Party. I have my own legislative record that people have combed over. I have taken political risk where I had no cover from anybody else and no safety net. Risks that were my own, and I have shown courage, I've shown the experience to work in a legislature, I've shown the ability to work with other people, work across the aisle, and to get things done no matter what, even when it was really, really uphill. And I think that's what sets me apart, is that I can work within this new Congress, but I'm not of the status quo.
Thank you. Representative A.
What sets this campaign apart is this is the first time this has ever been done in the history of our district. We're not accepting donations from the typical corporate PACs that dominate our politics, that many of you have formed PACs just to compete with these multinational corporations. And if it was up to all of us, if we were to take a vote, I imagine we'd all ban corporate PAC contributions together, even though this is the Chamber of Commerce. Over 5,000 people have contributed to our campaign, the average $20. So we're building a movement. It's really incredible what's happening. We're shifting power back from the privileged few billionaires like Donald Trump back to the people where it belongs in a democracy. Over my time in the State House, we've got more infrastructure school funding than any district in the state, broke the district record, passed meaningful legislation like same-day voter registration, reach across the aisle with Republicans to pass industrial hemp to legalize that across the nation after Maui's last sugar plantation. And that's the kind of cooperation and values-driven leadership that I'm seeking to bring to Congress. Thank you.
Thank you.
What sets me apart, first of all, is that I'm a mom. And I'm a single mom. And when I first got into office, I wasn't a mom. When I had my son, you get a different perspective. You see things from a different point of view, and that is so important. The other thing that sets me apart is that I ran a small business. I understand what businesses go through. I know how hard it is to have to meet payroll every month and all of the challenges that government puts forth to small businesses. I've served at all levels. I've served at the city level, I've served at the state level, and I've been elected to the House, to the Council, to the Senate. So I understand all levels of government and everything about Hawaii. I've served in leadership roles on the City Council. I was a zoning chair for 12 years. I understand land use. I understand how hard it is to get affordable housing and the permit system. In the Senate, I was a chair of the Ways and Means Committee. I had to balance a $20 billion budget to understand what is all the needs of our community, and I take that with me to Congress. And of course, thank you.
Council Chair.
Thank you. You can just call me Ernie Professor. Well, thank you. I mean, you know, it's an excellent question. I think, you know, I've been fortunate. I think I'm the only candidate who's sitting here before you here today that actually served in both branches of government. And actually, I'm a member of all three branches, if you really think about it, being an attorney by training. But I've served on the executive branch. You know, I've been a cabinet member, and now I serve on the legislative branch in leadership as the council chair himself. I think I've been fortunate in those capacities. I've worked across both aisles. When I say both aisles, it's not Republican or Democrat, because to me that's irrelevant. I've worked on the executive branch at the federal level, dealing with many agencies, and also at the congressional level in lobbying for funds that Hawaii had applied for in many instances. So, you know, I'm fortunate it's experience I can carry with me. My recent colleague, Tulsi Gabbard, who's now serving in Congress, entered the council with me. It's a pre-existing relationship I already have, and I think it will carry me very far should I have the opportunity to serve.
Thank you. Our next question deals with national security. Oh, wait. Oh, hi, Lieutenant Governor, how are you today? Would you like to answer this question?
I appreciate the chance to be able to answer this question, because I think that's a good one. We will all probably be very similar on the issues, and so it's good to say what sets us apart. For me, I, as the Attorney General, I had taken on President Trump in court, and I was able to be successful on multiple occasions in multiple courts. And the reason why I bring that up is because if I were to make it to Congress, I would actually be one of the very few members of Congress who's actually done that. There are not that many people who are former attorney generals who are there. I would have an opportunity to be able to be part of that and to really be able to challenge not just the Trump administration, but just to be able to make sure that we are defending all of Hawaii's values and also preserving the future.
Thank you. All right. Now I get to ask the national security question. What do you think is the top national security issue that could affect Hawaii businesses, and what would you propose to increase security? Representative Ng, we'll start with you.
I think this increased security question is a little, it's framed a little differently than I put it. I think the best way to kill an enemy is to turn them into a friend. Iran nuclear deal was a step in the right direction. We should be denuclearizing that area as aggressively as possible. I think it's very disappointing that Donald Trump went and tried to reverse that. And when he's making a similar deal with North Korea, I really hope that he's earnest, considering the action he's taken with Iran. When you do sanctions to one of these unstable nations, you consolidate wealth to the top, the people die, it becomes less stable. What we really need more is more diplomacy and open up trade barriers, because once trade gets in, then information gets in and people realize that they're being isolated and they get less aggressive and they want to be part of the globalized community. And that's how we lead in Hawaii. We're small, we're island, but you know, we also live on island Earth, and we do everything we can to cooperate and draw those connections. And I know that in this Chamber of Commerce, you folks know what that's all about.
Can you say the question again?
Sure. What do you think is the top national security issue that could affect Hawaii businesses, and what would you propose to increase security?
Well, I think the national security that affects businesses is President Trump and his tweeting, I think, and some of his policies on tariffs and not thinking things through. I think that affects, it has a ripple effect through all of the businesses. And certainly the issue with North Korea, I think that's all on our minds. January 13th, false missile alert certainly made us all aware that we need to be a lot more prepared. I think we need to support our military. We need to have a missile defense radar system that's going to be completed before 2023, and that we need to really consider having interceptors that can destroy incoming missiles. I think all of those kinds of things that affect the country as well as Hawaii trickles down to us, and it's very important that we stay very vigilant in watching all of these things. Thank you.
Thank you. You know, I think for Hawaii, the military, and especially our veterans, are very critical. You know, if you think the threat from Korea is an idle threat, I don't think so. I think the greater threat actually is from China. And I think it behooves Hawaii not to take that threat very seriously. And I think with respect to where we stand nationally, we need to ensure that the federal government continues to invest in Hawaii, in making sure that our military is properly equipped with all the latest technology and the troops that we need. You know, I know the chamber organized an event a couple years ago when we were thinking about downsizing Schofield Barracks. That's a district I represent, Wahiawa. If Schofield Barracks had downsized significantly in the degree that they had hoped for, Wahiawa would be a ghost town today. And so when you talk about affecting small business is the backbone. That's the backbone of not just Hawaii, of our nation. And especially in Hawaii, where we're so military dependent, it's critical that we continue that flow of revenue into our state.
Just making sure you call up. I was at the PACOM change of command last week when Admiral Swift handed over the command over to Admiral Aquilino. And Admiral Swift talked about the loss of a rules-based international order. And to me, that is really critical. The fact that the United States, potentially, even in the minds of many of our leaders, is starting to lose its leadership position in establishing a rules-based international order, that's of great concern. And the reason why that's important to businesses is because when the United States takes that kind of leadership stance, whether it's in establishing diplomacy or how it relates to other people, it impacts businesses as well. And particularly, it impacts the businesses in Hawaii that have so many ties to Asia.
Thank you. I think, you know, these were all really good points. One thing that nobody has talked about that I think is actually the biggest thing threat to our national security right now is privacy and cybersecurity. I think one of the things we need to do is follow the EU in increasing privacy standards and requirements for things for entities like Facebook. That's been a big discussion in Congress, and it's something that we've seen this Congress unable to deal with, in part because many of our Congress people did not grow up in a social media generation. That's something that I think I can help do as a young person. Understanding that data is a currency and that Russian interference and all these other things that could happen are a huge national security issue. The same thing is true with data breaches and grid resiliency. It's been said that one of the biggest threats to the American economy is the ability for other countries to be able to take over our electrical grid. That would be crippling to the American economy, to Hawaii's economy. We need to be making our grid more resilient and more secure, and that's something that we should be seeking federal funding for, and something that would be a really big priority for me as a congressperson.
Next question will deal with employer mandates. Do you support a federal mandate for paid family leave? Why? Do you support a federal mandate for paid family leave? Why?
First, let me say that I have supported a paid family leave here in the state, and we did pass Senate Bill 2990, which has a sunrise analysis. I do think that we need to look at all the effects that a paid family leave will have on businesses, but with our population growing older, and families are being required to look after their loved ones. I'm a caregiver for my mom. And the pressures that are on getting caregiving and getting affordable caregiving, that's something that we really have to take a strong look at. And how are we going to deal with, how is businesses going to deal with, because families will have to take care of families, and we're going to need family leave. So I do support family leave, but I think we need to leave it up to the states. Every state is different, and I believe that our state can do a better job as telling how do we deal with this issue than having it on a broad level at the federal level.
Thank you. I mean, I don't think anybody on this panel can say that they don't support paid family leave. I mean, it's a fundamental principle of the Democratic Party. I mean, how can you say you don't? You know, I think it's more, for me, it's a personal issue because of where I come from, coming from a larger family, growing up in poverty. You know, although my dad supported us, I mean, we didn't have to go on public assistance. That's only because he could work two or three jobs, so my mom couldn't work at that time. But what would have happened to us if my dad had got injured on the job, you know, and somehow there'd be a devastating event within the family itself that he couldn't work? My dad's a retired combat vet, so we were lucky. We were covered. You know, we always had our medical care taken care of. But there's a lot of other families out there who don't have that same privilege. You know, so I think it's very important that we protect not just one, we protect all. So thank you.
Okay, so Hawaii Chamber of Commerce, I think you're going to find out that the five Democratic candidates all support paid family leave. But I think what we're going to be telling you is this. I had a chance to be able to testify in favor of paid family leave at the state level. And in the process, I got to be involved in some great talks with small business owners who actually talked about really the great benefits that come from being able to give employees the ability to have paid family leave, and that in the long run, it was actually better for their business to be able to do something like that. At the federal level, I can understand the whole point about how it's actually important to just leave things to the state. Let the states be able to set the example first by being able to show that they're accomplishing something that's good with paid family leave, and that'll bring the other states on board.
Yes, so regarding paid family leave, you're right. I think we're all going to say that we support it. I have supported it, and you know, while we're talking about it, I also was able to draft the bill that we passed for equal pay. You know, my sister was a single mother at 20, and we could not have helped to raise her as a family and as a team if we had not had some strong family leave policies. The same is true when I was a kid. We had to move in with my grandma in Kalihi, and so I spent a good deal of my life in Kalihi helping to take care of my grandma. Same thing, without family leave policies, we would not have been able to do that. One of the things that I think we need to continue to talk about when we talk about family leave or any employer mandate is the importance. I do think we should do this on a federal level, but there is an importance to make sure that we continue to find common ground amongst businesses and amongst the needs of workers. And that's the hard work. It is very hard to find the compromise. People forget that. Sometimes it's seen as weak, but the truth is, to be able to go to different groups and say, we can't give you everything, but we can give you something, and this is how we're going to work and find solutions, is the key to being a good legislator and having courage to be able to do it that way.
Thank you. Yeah, likewise. Check, check. Check, 1, 2, 1, 2. Maybe, hello? Oh.
There it is.
Hello? Anybody, is this on?
No.
Okay. So just y'all? Okay, thank you. All right. Yes, I too support paid family leave, and yes, I support it on a federal level. I know that part of the question isn't always answered. This year, as majority policy leader, we fought to make paid family leave a priority for the House. And the question is what the model looks like. An employer mandate, fine. Are we expecting all the money to come from the employer? No, I think that is unreasonable. A system where everybody chips in what they can and everybody get back the service is something that I think most of us in the room can support, similar to Medicare, similar to Social Security. And that's actually the two most popular programs across the nation between parties. And we need to be thinking more along those lines. The same goes for Medicare for All. Why is it that we rely on employers to provide insurance when you should be focusing on growing your business and improving your products and services? And just kind of rethinking, just taking a step back from the way things have been done for 40 years and just coming back from the drawing board again with new ideas. Thanks, Beth.
Yeah.
Bernie, do you support an increase in the federal minimum wage? If so, to what level? Why?
Good question. You know, I would support an increase to the federal minimum wage. I mean, I think I experienced it firsthand. My youngest daughter just graduated from college, graduated from Portland State University, came back home, and actually, because she was independent in college, wanted to live in her own apartment in downtown Honolulu, because I represent, of course, Central Oahu North Shore. But, you know, the struggles she went through to find one decent job, let alone two decent jobs, to make ends meet, you know, shows that there is a necessity to raise it at a level where people can meet that standard of living and live very comfortably and still enjoy that quality of life, I think, that we all hope, not just necessarily for ourselves, but definitely for our children and our grandchildren. But to what that amount is, I mean, every state is different, so it's tough to make that determination. But it's something definitely that I would support.
My daughter is 19 years old. She's living in Philadelphia right now, going to college, and she's going to be 20 in a couple weeks. But she works at Uniqlo, the retail department store that's going to be opening up in Honolulu. She makes just close to minimum wage, and she actually thinks that she's making it on her own. What she doesn't realize is that her mom and dad are constantly subsidizing her all the time. So she's under the illusion that she's living on minimum wage. She's not. And so Hawaii Chamber of Commerce, I should tell you, I do support raising the minimum wage to $15 at the federal level. This is an important down payment that we are giving to the next generation. And how we're going to get there, what steps it's going to take for us to be able to make that happen, I think we can do it. And I think it's important just to be able to, as all of us think about our children and grandchildren, particularly here, we need to think of a way to be able to raise the minimum wage in a way that helps them.
You know, I agree with everyone. I think we do need to raise the federal minimum wage. I have signed on to petitions to raise the federal minimum wage. But I think the broader part of this conversation is that we can raise wages all that we want. But if we don't address the cost of living in Hawaii, we will never be able to pay people enough to continue to live here. That's why I continue to push things like affordable housing. That's been a cornerstone of every single piece of legislation that I have moved while I was in the state legislature. We have to make Hawaii more affordable, and we have solutions to do that, but people in power have not had the political courage to actually do anything about it. We might have done a little bit this year, but it wasn't nearly enough. There's so much more to do, but it is going to take the political courage to look for change, to seek change, and to pitch that change to the public.
I support a $15 minimum wage. In 2014, I mean, it's nice to have business owners in Congress. I think the vast majority, 50% of Congress members are millionaires. Only 1% of the public is. It helped, and I think it's even more important these days to have folks who actually worked the minimum wage job less than 10 years ago in Congress to represent that side of the equation. I was in Long's, I was in Walmart. My first race, nobody thought I had a chance. I was working at Four Seasons from 4 a.m. to noon, cleaning locker rooms, and I knock on doors until sunset. I get it. In 2014, we pushed towards a $12 minimum wage. We met at a 10-10 compromise, and my idea, Sherry was there in finance committee, was if we're going to raise a tip credit to $225, it will only be triggered if that individual was making the living wage. That was adopted. That compromise was adopted, and Obama actually took it up as his national policy. So we set the example right here in Hawaii through the idea that I presented to the finance committee in 2014, and that's the kind of innovation that you can expect from me in Congress.
The federal minimum wage is $7.25. That is out of touch with what's going on in the United States. So I do agree that we need to raise the federal minimum wage, and I believe all the states have higher minimum wages at this point. Having run a small business, though, I understand how difficult it is. So if we are looking at raising the minimum wage, we have to phase it in. We have to allow time for businesses to be able to factor it in, to plan for it, and to then allow their cash flow to be able to sustain the minimum wage as they go forward. These are the kinds of things that you have to run a business to understand how to balance, and that's the key. How do you balance? Because without a small business, if there are no jobs, if you go under, then nobody's going to have a minimum wage because you won't have a job. So we need to look at how do we balance that, how do we phase it in so that we can all benefit by it. Thank you.
Next question will have to do with trade. Do you see the current administration's tariff policies being helpful or not to Hawaii business? Why?
I don't think it's helpful, but I'll tell you why. I think there's a sense right off the bat that these kinds of tariffs will somehow be able to be competitive in the country. I don't think it's helpful for Hawaii, and I don't think it's helpful in terms of being able to help Hawaii have the kind of interaction that it needs to be having with different Asian countries and different Asian businesses. One out of five businesses that are in Hawaii are owned by someone who's foreign-born. And our ability to be able to have that kind of interaction and relationship with different entities is super important. You know, the biggest concern about any trade agreement agreement is this, is that it's got to make sure that it protects consumers and it protects the environment. And one of the things that, that I can see that, that is a challenge about everything is just making sure that these tariffs are ones that are not hurting our ability to do businesses in other countries.
Yeah, let me start by saying that I do believe tariffs are a legitimate tactic for making sure that we can build our local economy and build American economy and the American economy, but also recognizing that globalization is a real thing that we're going to always have to contend with. That's not going away. But tariffs can be a useful thing. I do not support these tariffs. I don't think that they're well thought out. I don't think that they're going to do the things that the Trump administration says that they're going to do. And I think that it's important to just continue going back to whatever policies, whatever tariff policies we put in place. This is something that we have talked about across party lines. This is something that both Republicans and Democrats have addressed in the past, but there is a good way to do it and there is a bad way to do it. The way that President Trump is presenting this will not help Hawaii businesses. They will not help American businesses. And that's what we need to be looking at, is protecting American jobs.
I fall in the Ricardian camp of economics, comparative advantage. I don't think that tariffs generally are a good thing, or categorically are a good thing. I think we need to open trade. We need to welcome immigrants. We need to welcome trade between borders. We need to open borders for business as much as possible. I think Hawaii will benefit. You want to talk about cost of living, that's the way to do it. Now, how do we maintain local businesses and make sure that we don't get outsourced through all this? Rather than disincentivizing imports, we can incentivize startups and make it easier for folks to start new businesses through Medicare for All, through universal basic income, and new ideas that I think is going to take a next generation of leadership to really champion.
I can be the microphone passer if that helps.
Thank you. You know, tariffs are vehicles to balance international trade. And international trade is so important to the U.S. economy, and it's important to our employment. And though these trade agreements, though, we have to monitor them, and we need to make sure that we continue to see if they're advantageous to our economy as well. We need to keep in mind that we need to be strategic as we look at these trade tariffs, because they have the trickle-down effect. And just because it's done for one industry doesn't mean that these countries have we seen, because of the steel tariffs, that it's going to affect all the other types of goods and services that we in Hawaii need so badly. And so I really believe that as the world changes, we need renegotiation of these international trade agreements as well as our trade partners. Thank you.
Thank you. My question actually is, do we actually have a tariff policy? You know, I mean, you can say that for any initiative or policy decision by President Trump. You know, he'll take a hardline approach one day, and the next day he'll go the opposite way. You know, I think it's a mistake if we go the hardline approach. Only because if you know, and this is the Chamber of Commerce, you know, one in every five jobs in Hawaii is tied to either the export or import industry. I mean, that's the reality of the situation. And we interact heavily with our Asian brothers and sisters, and it's an important business commodity for us. But I think in overall, in general, with regards to the president himself, you know, as a former athlete, it's very frustrating, I would think, for his cabinet to work with him. You know, it's like playing football. We call a play in the huddle, we're going to go left. We come out of the huddle, we break the huddle, the ball is snapped, the quarterback goes right. That's President Trump, you know what I mean? He's so unpredictable in terms of his overall orientation and philosophy. It's very difficult to know which way our country is headed.
Next question has to do with workforce development. What educational policies can the federal government encourage that would better prepare our students to be productive members of the workforce?
Sure. I think one of the things, the number one thing that I would say we need to look at is making sure that college, people can get out of college debt-free. If you want to go to college, then you should be able to go and get out of it debt-free. Again, as somebody who came out of school with a lot of student debt, that's a big passion of mine. It's one of the things that's crippling my generation and keeping us from being able to buy homes. That said, I think one of the other things we need to be looking at is what do we do when people don't want to go to college? Vocational training, increasing vocational training and funding for that within our schools, making sure that people do have jobs, looking at things like federal job programs, looking at things like universal basic income and all these other different options to make sure that even as things are becoming automated, that we know how we're going to adapt to that new economy. Again, this goes back to we need to make sure that we have the right people in Congress who can adapt, who can work with these changing technologies and who are of a generation that knows that change is coming and we need to be able to handle that. Oh, sorry. I can pass it back.
Should we just pass around? Like,
I got it, no. Yeah.
Okay. Education on the federal level, as you know, a lot of this is state. We're the only state that doesn't have county-funded education. We're 51st in the nation when it comes to facility funding. I say 51st because D.C. is not a state. They're number 50, and they spend twice as much as we do on education facilities. If we spent, you know, criminal justice is a big thing. We spent $64,000 per prisoner and only $12,000 per student. If we reverse that, we wouldn't need that many prison beds in the future anyway. So it's about shifting these paradigms and the way we look at these issues. I support stopping the divestment in Native Hawaiian Education Act and making it permanent. I support tuition-free college, free education from childcare all the way through college because you know you should be able to meet your educational potential whether you live in Kalihi, Hawaii Kai, or Aia. And lastly, new ideas because education is different now. A lot of it's going to be self-taught, online, module-based, and it's important that we give folks opportunity to pursue those sorts of things through bright ideas like universal basic income. I'll be happy to talk more about it in an upcoming question. Thanks.
Education is the equalizer, and I'm the only one in my family to graduate from college, and I understand how hard it is to work to be able to put yourself through college, so I support affordable college tuition. I also believe that the federal government can help us in the sense of providing federal funds for our community colleges and making community colleges a lot cheaper, a lot more accessible, and possibly you could go for a nominal amount. The other thing that the federal government can do is to refund Head Start. You know, they defunded Head Start, and that was a good policy, a good program to help those kids that have lost their way to be able to get through Head Start and then enter college. So I really think that we need to work with businesses. Businesses need to work with the university to be able to identify what are the skills, what do we need in order to get our workforce ready to enter into the work field. Thank you.
You know, I think any person who wants an opportunity to go to college should be afforded that opportunity. You know, like the senator, I'm the only one from my family who went on to college. Actually, out of the nine of us, only four of us actually graduated from high school. You know, but at that time, when I entered the university, I was fortunate I had athletic and academic scholarships. Otherwise, that door would be closed for me as well. You know, when you talk about a president who wants to spend $6 billion plus on a wall between the United States and Mexico, surely that money can be spent elsewhere. We have a homeless crisis, not just in Hawaii, nationwide. You know, you don't see him talking about that. Why? Because probably in his equation, they don't vote anyway. Why should I spend money on them? Well, you know what? They're human beings. No different than any other problem we have nationwide, right? Infrastructure. We have crumbling infrastructure, not just in Hawaii, all over the nation. You know, but we're not making the proper investments. So, you know, there's ample opportunities, I think, for a publicly funded educational system at the college level.
And I support workforce development programs to train and retrain Hawaii's employees to be able to power Hawaii's economy from now and into the future. I had the opportunity in 2016 to participate in a national think tank, Republicans and Democrats from all across the country, of lieutenant governors, secretaries of state, and attorneys general. And one of the things that people talked about is how, as much as everyone is trying to get a college degree or a high school degree, that there's also a large market for just making sure that people are prepared to enter the workforce. And so having that kind of workforce development opportunities is absolutely critical to be able to power our economy. And I'm not talking about just supporting the service economy. It's also making sure that we're able to leverage that into developing other economies that are good for Hawaii, such as clean energy, as well as other STEM-type jobs.
Taxes. Do you see the current administration's tax plan as being helpful to Hawaii business? Why?
Nominally, yes. I think in the long term, it's a sign of where our values are. We have a tax program that greatly benefits some of the richest corporations in the nation, mostly campaign donors, at the expense of working families and middle class people and small business owners across the nation. Frankly, I would have voted no. I would have stood with the rest of the Hawaii delegation and looked for a more fair tax program that would ease the burden on everyday folks and small business owners, but actually make corporations pay their fair share. It's not like labor versus business like it used to be back in the day. It's all of us together in the same canoe. When prices go up for like bread or like commodities or milk, like we all suffer, right? It's just the only people that really benefit is the top 0.1%. Last year in America, 82% of new wealth created went to the 1%, right? So that's not even us in the room right now. So it's just recognizing that and really shifting power back to the many from the few.
You know, as long as I've been in elective office, there is no perfect plan, and certainly this tax plan has a lot of issues with it. I am concerned about the long-term effect of the new tax plan in the sense of the area in that they have reduced the mortgage interest deduction that you can take, and that certainly is affecting Hawaii more than any of the other states because of our high real estate costs. And however, I have to admit that there have been some benefits to the tax plan, certainly some short-term benefits, and I think the residents who've gotten them are happy about that. The bonuses that many in the financial banks have given short-term bonuses to the employees have certainly benefit, and it's good to see some of the employees that have reinvested some of their savings back into the community, back into their businesses. And so in that sense, those parts of the tax plan, but on the long-term effects of the tax plan, I think that I have some concerns, because when we're looking down 10 years from now, but who knows what's going to happen. You know, we have a change in Congress, and we can extend and cut some of the taxes and increase some of the benefits.
This is cut. But you know, I agree with Kaniala in terms of the president's tax plan itself. I mean, it's benefited a few, primarily big businesses. I mean, if you look at the savings that was realized or the profits that were realized from the president's tax package, you know, a lot of those proceeds went to stock options, went to dividends. Although some bonuses were given out, I mean, they probably could have given significantly more. But of course, you know, knowing the nature of a big business, they had to redirect more of them towards their stockholders. Otherwise, they wouldn't invest in the company. You know, I would have liked to see a plan that would have redirected a lot of those proceeds towards employee training. I think that that's something that all businesses struggle with, especially as quickly as society advances, the technology that changes daily. You know, keeping our workers up to speed, because it's a very competitive environment, and I would have preferred to see, you know, a plan that would have directed more of the revenues towards that focus.
Well, I totally agree with Kaniela as well. How great is that for Democratic unity? I'm sure by now you're hoping that you invited a Republican to this event. I want to say this. I truly believe it's the tax cuts, it's legislative class warfare. It's taking the money from public school teachers and putting it into the hands of private jet owners and some of our largest corporations. Plain and simple, that's what's happening. I don't believe it helps small businesses. And I had a great talk with someone recently about how he did see how the Trump tax cuts was able to help him to make some more investments in the short term. The concern I have is actually I think that the federal tax program could have been even better. What's happened is some very poorly drafted legislation that people can drive a truck through. And I think everybody on the stage knows just how bad it is when you have legislation that's been poorly drafted, that contains a lot of loopholes, that's room for a lot of abuse. I think we need real tax reform that's going to be able to help small businesses as well as local people and working families to do even better than what exists now.
Yeah, I think I'm going to reiterate what everybody else said, and I'll just throw something in just, you know, to mix it up a little. I think, first of all, I would say that big everything is a problem. When I ran for office, that was what I was running against, big everything. The things that drown out the smaller voices. I think this tax plan, it may have helped at first. I think people feel like they're seeing some immediate benefits. My biggest concern is that I feel like it's deceptive. It gave people some instant paychecks, some instant rewards to make them feel like this was a good idea so that we can have a midterm election that maybe Republicans will do better than they wanted to do, and they bought those people off. And I think what we need to do is make sure that those middle tax breaks stay in place. And then the other thing, I want to compare this to the banking bill that was just passed. There are many good things in that banking bill that will help smaller banks be able to do loans for local families, but what we also saw is that big banks and big corporations that caused the problems for us in 2008, it was a boon for them. They're now not going to have to be put to the same tests and the same level of scrutiny that they need to be to make sure our economy is safe. And that's what we're seeing from this administration, and that's what I think we need to see change.
Diana, how do we balance the sustainability of Hawaii businesses with Hawaii's environment?
I'm sorry, say that again. I was kidding.
How do we balance the sustainability of Hawaii's businesses with Hawaii's environment?
Yeah, our environment here is so important. That's what sets us apart from a lot of other destinations. And of course, tourism is our number one industry, and people come here because of our environment. I personally am green. I have photovoltaic, I have an electric vehicle, and while sometimes it costs more, it's something that I'm committed to. And similarly, I know for the businesses that going green is not necessarily cheaper, it's not necessarily going to save money. Many times it costs more, but I think we have to look at the long-term environment. And so what do we want this aina to look like? What do we want to leave for our next generation? And if we want to leave what we have and leave it a better, then we all need to step up to see what is it that we can do. I think it's important that we phase in whatever it is that government wants businesses to do as far as sustainability of the environment, that we have to balance it, we have to phase it in. We have to give time for businesses to absorb that and to get onto the program. Thank you.
I had to say this, but when Senator mentioned that she's green, I had to laugh because I consider myself black and blue from being beaten up by Dennis Francis's Star Advertiser editorial board. I see him here and I got a chuckle. But, you know, I think it's a mistake, I think, for President Trump to pull out of the Paris Climate Accord. But fortunately, with respect to Honolulu, I can only speak for Honolulu, that, you know, we already had the vision and leadership to go forward with a charter amendment to establish an Office of Climate Control and Accountability, which puts us ahead of the game, I think, on this particular issue. But the senator is right. Why do people come to Hawaii? Right? It's because of our environment, what we offer. And if we don't protect what we have, you know, with all the various challenges that we all facing, look what's happening on the Big Island. You know, it's an issue that we're going to have to address. You know, you think it's only happening on the Big Island, but believe me, it'll reflect on the state as a whole as we go forward. So even the county, at the city and county of Honolulu, we got to pay attention to that because potentially it will have some adverse effects. So thank you.
I think that's a fantastic question for the business community, and what I can say about that is that I think that is honestly a cost of doing business here in Hawaii, is that culturally, legally, constitutionally, we just respect our environment. But I'll give you a few examples of success stories that show how things are able to work. For example, when Turtle Bay was able to work out a conservation easement that allowed them to be able to settle with the people of Oahu for over decades-long dispute, that allowed them to be able to preserve 660 acres in a conservation easement. That was a terrific win-win for business as well as the environment. Another one was when there was a molasses spill that was involved in Honolulu Harbor by a shipping company here. They were able to work out a settlement that was able to restore coral reefs and really make a big difference in the community in that way, to make reparations for what happened. So I think there are answers. I was fortunate to be part of those two projects, and I think there's a way to do it.
I think the mistake that is often made is that the two things are mutually exclusive, right? The economy and the environment. In Hawaii, the environment is our economy. Sustainability is something that Hawaii businesses need to be able to survive. The economic issues that we face in Hawaii are things that can be fixed by increased environmental laws and increasing our clean energy goals, especially. We've seen new businesses because of those goals. I think this goes back to one of the things that we've been talking about recently, is that much of this new development we're talking about could be threatened because of sea level rise. We could see, you know, 10 to 20 years, huge flooding problems in downtown Honolulu, and we need to be prepared to combat that, and we can't, and it's going to be costly. It's going to be costly for businesses and the people of Hawaii if we don't plan up front. This goes back to the need for long-term planning, for working with all parties involved, and doing the hard work of finding compromises, you know. And I think I would want to also add here, I think a lot of these cases that the former Attorney General brought up were great wins for the Ige administration, and they have done a good job in trying to make sure that we're protecting our lands, and you know, that's one of the things we have to do, but there are many, many, many more things we have to do to make sure that our environment is safe and that we also are able to keep growing our economy.
You know, as a Native Hawaiian, sustainability is not just a buzzword. It just was our way of life for many, many years. We had 1 million people on these islands like we do today. And we just lasted, we sustained ourselves for centuries. Now, you know, if the ports were to close, it would only last a few days. So things have changed quite a bit. And how do we get back to those basics is the question. We respectfully disagree with the senator. We do not have much time to phase things in. Within my son's lifetime, Waikiki will be underwater. The neighborhood that he grew up in will be underwater. 3 foot sea level rise unless we take immediate action in the next 15 years to get back on the Paris Climate Accord and move to 100% renewable energy nationwide by 2030. We can do it. We have the solutions. We just need the political will and for business owners to rise to the challenge.
Infrastructure. What do you see as the major infrastructure challenges to Hawaii? And what can be done about them at the federal level? How should it be financed?
Thank you. You know, running for office, I mean, other than people telling me, well, you should stay within the council itself because, you know, you've been doing a good job. You shouldn't move on to Washington, D.C. And one of the biggest complaints we hear is the infrastructure itself, primarily our roads. You know, it's unfortunate. I think the city has invested a significant amount of revenues with regards to that particular issue. I think when I first came into the council, that was one of our highest priorities. I think we more than quadrupled the budget for the road rehabilitation program. But you know what's disappointing, Professor, is when you go up to the Department of Transportation and they tell you that Hawaii is sitting on $750 million in federal highway funds that hasn't been spent, and here you are coming and asking me for more money for your rail project. You know what? There's a door, right? I mean, if we cannot spend what we already have, how can you go and lobby for more funds? You know, I think that's a problem. Even though this is a congressional office, you need to put pressure on the state to make sure those funds are being spent appropriately and expediently so we can compete for more dollars.
one of the best ways at the federal level to be able to help out with infrastructure would be to seek being on the Transportation and Infrastructure Committee in Congress. And I realize that any one of us, if we're elected to that seat, would be a freshman congressman. But I can tell you right now that that's a committee that I'd be looking for, because I know how important it is that we have federal funding to be able to help our transportation infrastructure. I think we all understand that well in urban Oahu. But I think also to the things that we can do to be able to rebuild our roads, our bridges, those are all things that are in the federal space. And I feel very committed to making sure that if I'm elected, that I would do everything I can to work with the congressional delegation, as well as to seek whatever it takes in order to be able to make sure that we're able to repair our infrastructure. It's that important.
This has been something that I've been talking about for a really long time, because again, I'm going to go back to affordable housing. Our affordable housing issue is also an infrastructure issue. We cannot get more affordable housing until we fix our infrastructure problems. Those are our biggest problems in Hawaii. One of the things as a congressperson I would be looking to do is to expand the community development block grant, which is currently going to rural areas, and that is important. But I think in Hawaii, especially in Congressional District 1, we need to be focusing on developing along the urban core, and there are grants at a federal level that we can use to do that. It's understanding and knowing those grants, taking the time to know what the pots of money are. Additional things we should be looking for, things to improve our sewers. People don't always know that can be a federal issue. It is soil remediation and grid resiliency. Again, I have to go back to, we won't be able to fix everything in Hawaii. We won't be able to reach our sustainability goals unless we fix our grid. And that's another thing that can be federal funded, and we just haven't looked hard enough for that money. So my job as a congressperson would be to look for that money and to make sure that infrastructure can get put in place so that we can build affordable housing and let our families continue to live here in Hawaii.
Thank you. Actually, I think that our delegation is actually doing a great job looking for funding for Hawaii, and they're actually delivering very well. In the State House, I was able to get more infrastructure funding for our district in my 6 years than since statehood. And it was a priority, because when I knock on doors, even now when we knock on doors with volunteers, we hear roads, sewers, that's the stuff people care about. Potholes, there's no Republican or Democratic potholes, right? So meet people where they are, and then you can kind of lead with ideas after that. There's no earmarks like there used to be in Congress. There's no Senator Inouye like there used to be in Congress. So what we need to do is be more pragmatic about the way we approach solutions. Rail is breaking the backs of Hawaii residents because there's not 49 states helping. And there should be. It has the lowest percentage of federal funds out of any mass infrastructure project in the nation. So that's why we need to be, while we're not in power, Republicans are in power right now, we should be pushing the issues, talking about why we need a $3 trillion infrastructure investment across the nation. So when we get back in power, we have the public with us, just like how the right did on their side. And that's what I'm seeking to do in order to ease the burden on Hawaii residents.
You know, that's the key, funding. How do you get the money? How do you get the federal funds? Every state wants their share of federal funds. And you can look for it all you like, but if you don't have a united delegation all working together with the same priorities, and that is very important that we work together as a delegation, and that we're able to form alliances with other states, support them so they can support us so we can support our agenda. I think that is key, that you have to have those relationships. I don't know, you know, no matter what you do as far as funding money, that is so important. You can consider raising taxes on the gas, federal tax, and so forth, but Hawaii already pays the highest taxes and the highest gas cost in the nation. And so we really have to make sure that we are able to work to get that critical federal funding for infrastructure, because without infrastructure, without sewers, without water, we can't build more affordable housing. And if we don't have the transportation system in place, again, we're not going to be building in the areas we need to build in.
Thank you. For our final question, we'll take it back to where we started. Personal experience. What do you like to do in your free time?
Oh, my goodness.
Do not tell me you don't have any.
I go running. I have two dogs. They're both Shih Tzu mixes, so they're great. I walk them around my neighborhood near my school. And the other thing, I got to tell you this, as awesome as it's been to be, I mean, it's really been a blessing to be a public servant as long as I have been. My wife and I are actually pretty introverted. And so what happens is that when away from going around and talking to everybody and spending all this time, and as wonderful as this is, we just like to go home and read. And that's what we do, and it's been that's our experience. Our kids are 20 and 17. We're going to be empty nesters soon, so I think we're going to be doing a lot of reading after that.
I'm going to add to that. Yeah, on the 1 to 10 introvert scale, I'm always a 10, so I understand, which makes this job rough sometimes. Huh? But I, you know, again, I do yoga. I spend a lot of time just decompressing at home. But for me, a big part of my life is my family. Again, I mentioned my 10-year-old niece. I've been co-parenting her with my sister since she was born. I knew all about the morning feedings because she needed somebody there to help her. And so I'm still there. She's a ballerina, and so my job is to take her shopping for all the clothes and do all the makeup and be that dance mom for her. That's a big part of my life. And also spending time with my parents, who have been such big supports in all of my campaigns. My campaign has always been all about my parents and them coming out to help me. My father in my first race came out with a giant sign because he thought I wasn't sign waving enough, a giant sign that said, "I'm Beth's dad, she's at work, please vote for my daughter." And this campaigning has been a family affair for us for years, and I've been blessed with a family that's been very, very willing to help me and be there for me through every aspect of my life. I'm sorry.
Yeah, you know, I echo the people up here. Like, we do disagree on some issues. It wasn't really brought up. But I know that everyone who serves, especially here in Hawaii, are doing it for the right reasons because they care about our state and our families and the people we love. Like, politics is personal. For me, I like to surf. I like to play basketball. I like to play music with my friends. I'm originally a music major before Linda Lingo cut our university by $130 million. So that's how I like to spend my time. Nowadays, I have a 2-year-old son, so probably every second of my free time is with him. So, you know, if I'm playing guitar, he's also like trying to stop it from happening, so I can look at him. So that's been pretty much my entire life now, and that's why I do this, right? Like I said, Waikiki will be underwater. 70% of my classmates moved away from Kamehameha School to private school. It's a job, right? So I just want to make sure that he has a shot to make it here. It's literally that simple.
What's that free time? I spend time with my son. I have one son, and so that's so important. My mom requires caregiving, and I do that. I spend time with my mom. I spend time with the community boards. I'm on the board of directors of my community association. I'm on the board of directors for the National Foundation of Women Legislators, requires me to travel such time. So what little time left over after that is I love to bake. I bake cookies, I bake pies that people love, and I use that to thank them because there's so many people in my life that's helped me along the way, continue to help me. That's one of the few ways that I can thank them by giving something of my own personal self, and that's my baking, so thank you.
You know, I never get any cookies from the senator. But you know, you know, actually, when I came today, Chad Blair was telling me, I was talking to Chad Blair real briefly, but, you know, Chad knows we are in session. We're in session year-round. We don't have a defined period of time that we work. We work year-round. So actually, the folder in front of me, I just came from a hearing. I need to run back to a hearing when we're done with this. But, you know, people who know me personally, know this. On Sunday, I never take any political events. It's important to me that I spend Sunday with my family. My dad is 94 years old. He's still alive. I have lunch with him every Sunday. Only cause, so he can tell me he saw me on TV and why did I vote this way. Then at night I have dinner with my kids and my in-laws. I do all the cooking. I enjoy that, you know. And again, when I have dinner with them, then they tell me, how come I never vote this way, you know, on a particular bill. But I always make it a point never to discuss business, whether it's in my law practice, whether it's what I do on the city council, because family time is family time. When you come from a family of nine, and you got to scrape for what you eat on a given night. Family time is very critical. So I wanted to thank you, Professor, for giving me this opportunity and allowing me to go beyond my time. But you take a risk with the Portuguese up here.
Thank you. We will now move to closing remarks. We started at the beginning of the alphabet. We are, in fairness, going reverse. Today, the alphabet ends with M. We will start with M.
Thank you. You know, really briefly, you know, I think a lot of people think they know me, you know, but a lot of people don't know me because I rarely talk about myself. You know, one of the things I always hear, especially among my supporters, and I see them in the crowd trying to motion to me to smile, you know, because that's the criticism I always get. Ernie, how come you don't smile? You know, how come you don't smile when you're on TV? Because you're on TV a lot. People think you're mad. You know, I'm not mad. You know, I'm actually a very happy-go-lucky guy if you know me personally. You know, I don't smile because every time the media interviews me, it's always on bad news. And how can you smile giving bad news? But for any of you, you know, is any of you in here ever raised in public housing? Any of you? Yeah? You know the reality in public housing. You know the reality in public housing is you always got to be on your toes. And when I was growing up, this is what my older brothers taught me. You never smile. You know why you never smile? Because if you smile, it shows weakness. And if you show weakness, that's when the bullies are going to come by and try to take money off of you. I mean, that's the reality. When I got into politics, I had to learn how to smile. I couldn't smile. If you saw my early political pictures, never smiling. You know how people got me smiling? They would have to stand behind the camera and make those ears, rabbit ears, to make me laugh. And that's the only way they would catch me smiling. But of course, now I can. You know, because I feel I'm very fortunate in life. You know, I get to serve on the city council every day. You know, serving on the city council is an opportunity to help someone. You know, I've been fortunate in my tenure. I mean, you know, when I was kind of a little disappointed when the governor mentioned Turtle Bay, Lieutenant Governor mentioned Turtle Bay, because actually that was a county initiative. The state just came in at the back end, and it wasn't Governor Iggy, it was Governor Abercrombie. Because I told the governor when that first came along, Governor, I'll put in $5 million. You come up with the rest. And he told me, oh, yeah, Ernie, for sure. You know, you can't come up with $5 million. Bang, in the budget, $5 million the next week. You know, and that allowed us to go forward and do Turtle Bay. So, you know, I'm proud. I mean, there's many other achievements, I think. Not me individually, but collectively. I'm fortunate. I serve with a good group. And if this is the last shot I have in serving in politics, you know, I can walk away with my head held up high. But thank you. Thank you, Professor.
Thank you all very much. You know, this is a very important election. There are serious consequential decisions that will have to be made on the national level as well as on the global level. And so Hawaii really needs to have a strong but experienced voice, a leader and someone who can bring people together. To form alliances that will help Hawaii and not hurt us or not isolate us. I have a 35-year record of delivering to my constituents, and I've made consequential decisions that have affected people's lives time and time again. My record shows that I've not been afraid to stand up and take on the hard issues, you folks know that, and do the right thing. And this campaign is about who you can trust. Who you can trust to deliver on their promises. It's not about political ambition. It's not about climbing the political ladder. It's about who can get the job done. And that's what I do. When Farrington High School needed lights for the field because they were told that there was no money left and we needed to do it right away, they came to see me and we got the lights for the field. When the Pākehi residents on Pākehi Avenue, homes are going to be condemned by the city to expand Kapiolani Park. They came to see me, and we saved their homes. That's just what I do. I get the job done. It's about electing a person that can bring stability and bring continuity to our delegation, and that's why I'm committed to serve in Congress for as long as the voters will allow me to do it. You know, we've talked about standing up and fighting Trump. And we have a lot of people in Congress that's fighting Trump. And I can fight Trump just as well as anybody else. But what I want to do in Congress is fight for Hawaii. We need to fight for all of the things that this small state needs so badly.
So we need that strong, experienced voice, that voice that's going to fight for Hawaii, that's going to fight for our local values. And I hope that you will all make sure that you go to the polls, because this is a very important election. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you everyone for being here. I really appreciate you taking the time out of your lunch to hear from us and to participate in the civic process. It's very important. You know, there's been a lot of talk about I this, I that, rattling down our resumes. I don't think that's what people really care about these days. We saw that when Obama was elected after just being in office for 6 years, and he proved to be quite a good president. We saw that again in the change election, where folks were so frustrated that they went with a misogynistic bigot as our president. And that's the desperation that people are facing now. They just want change. People are just fed up with the institutions, whether it's government, multinational corporations, or whatever. They just feel like their voices have been silenced. And if we don't harness that energy, if we don't say, I feel your pain, I'm going through it too, and here are some solutions that help out everyone, and we're not scapegoating immigrants, rather we're locking arms with immigrants and people of color and the LGBTQ community and people with disabilities and women, and we're saying, if you come from one of us, you're gonna have to take all of us. Right, that's what we're about. That's what the progressive values of Hawaii is about, right? Then that's why we need to fight for aloha. We need to fight for aloha. We need to restore these values. Senator Akaka was just put to rest just a few days ago. And I remember seeing him on TV when I was a kid, and he looked like me and talked like me and dressed like me. And I'm like, Brad, this is something I think I could do, public service. And I think we're missing that now. This is all these cookie cutter politicians. You look in Congress, they're all millionaires, they're all corporate lawyers. Nothing against lawyers, y'all, but like, where's everybody representing normal folks, right? And that's what makes Hawaii so special. I think that's what needs to be restored, that voice for just working people that understand what it means to sweat and work your fingers to the bone in the pineapple field. And that's the perspective I seek to bring and build seniority over the decades, if the people are willing, in order to have a voice in this as a small state. So mahalo, Dr. Hart, and everybody. Aloha.
Well, thank you so much. I want to reiterate by thanking everybody for being here today. You know, I didn't talk much about my family background yet. My grandfather was a labor leader in New York City. He taught me, he was on the front lines of labor in the 1960s. He taught me that the most important thing a person can do in their life is to stand up for people that don't have a voice and to be that voice for them. My other grandfather was a small business owner in Kalihi. He ran a family grocery store. He was a butcher in that store. And he taught me that hard work and honor and respect and civility were the most important things that you could carry as values. I was taught by those two men. Those are my values, and those are the values that I've taken into my career. I have a demonstrated record, as I've said, of courage, of standing up to the status quo, even when there was no net to catch me and no one to cover me. I fought uphill battles my entire life to get here and to be on this stage with these people here. And it hasn't been easy for me. That's why I'm the right person to send to Congress. We should send revolutionaries, because they're the ones that are gonna make a difference this election cycle. We didn't send people in the past. We weren't sending people who had been in and around politics for decades, who had their chance to make a difference, had their chance to keep our kids home in Hawaii, and missed it. Because now our kids are leaving, and there's no place for the people of my generation to stay here anymore unless we make big change. When she went to Congress, Patsy Meigh was a woman in her 30s with only a little bit of legislative experience. Sometimes people forget that, but her history was that she had a lot of fight and she never settled for the status quo. This election could usher in the biggest freshman class Congress has seen in decades. It will be a Congress of change and opportunity, and Hawaii can be a part of that, but only if we send the right person to Congress. The next person that we send needs to be able to work in that new Congress. They need to be able to adapt to the changing needs of our country. They need to make sure that we have a clear and tested leader who is balanced, who knows how to work across the aisle, who knows when to fight, but knows when to work behind the scenes, who's not looking for the credit, who wants to make sure that we can just get things done for our state. I want to be that person. I want to be able to serve in Hawaii, gain that seniority, gain the influence to make sure that working families always have a voice. Thank you.
I want to talk about three people that I was able to meet on during my campaign. One of them was he was Wayne. He was a flight attendant for Hawaiian Airlines. He grew up in Molokai, and he recently purchased a house in Texas because he couldn't afford a home in urban Honolulu. Somebody else that I talked to was a retiree named Joyce, who lives on disability, has grandchildren that are going to be going into college, and she was really concerned about what was going to be happening for the next generation now. And then finally, one of my very good friends was Roger, who's a member of the Chamber of Commerce, and he actually runs a youth flag football league that's a franchise and does very well. And all of them had so many different interests and priorities, and it was great to be able to talk to them. But one of the things that really affected me was for all of them, I think they all acknowledged, just like everybody in this room, is that we are living in very unusual times here in the United States. Our country is in a very different place than where we've ever been before, or at least in this generation. And so because of that, I think it's very important for us to realize that in these unusual times, we can't just have the usual politicians that are involved. I got involved in this race on December 19th, 2017. That is the first time I started asking people to donate money to my campaign. I've been a public servant for 20 years, and during that time, it's been my fortune to be a prosecutor, to be the managing director of the city and county, to be the attorney general, and now to be the lieutenant governor. And in each one of those positions, I feel like I'm gonna be able to understand what is Hawaii's values and to be able to communicate them at a national level. So my final closing thought is this, is I can be a national voice. If you vote me into DC, not only will I be able to stand up for everything that Hawaii stands for, but I can be a national voice in terms of things like immigration, in terms of gun control. I would be the first person from law enforcement to be elected to Congress in Hawaii. There are many things that I could be able to say that would communicate what is so important to Hawaii. Mahalo.
Thank you, candidates. Thank you, Kay, our timekeeper. Thank you to the chamber for hosting. Most importantly, of course, thank you for our audience. None of this works unless you vote. Thank you very much.